Thank you very much, Haldor. Can everybody hear me? Is that okay? Great. Thank you very much. Yes, it's wonderful to be here. A real delight to be in Heidelberg for actually almost a week. And actually, I'm really excited to be able to give this talk today because this is a topic, a project, sort of a pet project of mine. It's actually, I'll tell you a little bit about it in a minute, one of the first projects I started when I moved into the social studies of science. I've published a bit on it, but I haven't actually spoken about it before. So this is a first, which is really nice to be able to kind of to share with you and get some of your thoughts and feedback on this. So as Haldor said, and I'll just sort of recap this briefly because it is relevant to the project, my career has kind of so far spanned both the natural and the social sciences. So I started off doing a PhD in sort of cell biology, looking at mechanisms of cell migration, and really enjoyed my time at the lab bench, but also for the throughout my undergraduate and graduate degrees, had been really interested in some of the broader questions surrounding the funding of science, kind of how decisions get made, how science is regulated, and so on. And wasn't quite sure how to pursue this. So, you know, where should I go to work, you know, to kind of start to play with these ideas. And I managed to get an internship at Nature. So it was a 6-month internship that turned into 18 months. Not a very fancy job. I was copy editing all the manuscripts that had been accepted for publication. So, you know, about 6 or 7 hours is spent per manuscript at Nature, formatting it into house style, writing it in such a, helping to rewrite the articles in such a way that the sort of language drops out and the science emerges. And for me, working at a place like Nature was just a fascinating insight into the world of science. How decisions get made, what counts as good science, the politics of publishing, and so on. And this experience really made me realize that I was interested in going back into academia and to study science in some way. So I moved to Edinburgh, and worked at a unit, a very unusual unit at the time, which no longer exists. It had 10 years of funding, finished a couple of years ago, a unit called the ESRC Genomics Policy and Research Forum. And it was there that I began to do some work on synthetic biology, and I also began to retrain in the social studies of science. And in fact, the first project that I did is the project that I'll be speaking about today, which in a way sort of tries to connect my PhD work and my experiences at Nature, but really try and understand them. So this was my first attempt to really try and understand from a kind of social studies of science perspective some of the developments that I had experienced and been part of over eight years of kind of scientific training. So what I'm going to talk about today really is the role of images in science, and using scientific digital image processing as a very specific case study of this. But just to start by saying that actually images are central features of, well, in fact, of science, but particularly of journal articles, right? So now if you open an issue of virtually any scientific journal, it would be very unusual to have a page that doesn't have a figure on it. Some, you know, a chart, a table, a diagram, a graph, you know, an electron kind of microscopy image, a blot, some kind of image on it. And actually, in fact, I don't know if this is the same. I'm guessing most people in the room are scientists, practicing scientists, yeah? That actually the way that scientists often read papers is to read the abstract, to look at the figures, to read the captions, maybe to read the introduction and conclusion, and often to skip much of the middle parts, right? That the images are kind of a central way of sort of accessing a paper, right? So they're a fundamental way that scientists communicate with each other, and they're also a way that they communicate more broadly their findings. So attached to this, then, is a sense that when you look at an image, it's really important that you can trust the image, that you can trust that the person who has prepared the image is actually showing you a slice of the world and is making a compelling argument and is one that actually you feel then that you are equipped to look at and validate for yourself and follow the argument that they're making. So it's actually critical that you can trust the image that is there. And actually, if you can't trust the image, if it turns out there's something slightly strange with the image or that, you know, something doesn't quite fit, then maybe you start to question the claim that's being made, the argument of the paper, perhaps the skill of the scientist. A lot is built on this. So things start to kind of collapse or to get, you know, really kind of really difficult to manage if it turns out that the image, that there's something kind of odd about how the images, you know, are presented to you, if they don't quite seem to work. And this is particularly prevalent in cases of fraud, right? So this is probably one of the most high-profile cases of kind of scientific fraud in the last 15 years or so. The South Korean stem cell researcher Hwang, whose paper that was published in June 2005, was retracted on the grounds of many different kind of forms of misconduct, one of which, though, was to do with the duplication of images in panels. So actually, you know, this paper was one that claimed to be the first demonstration that you could derive human embryonic stem cells from adult patients. These were sort of the eight different stem cell lines, and actually you can see here that sort of the same image, just very visibly in the panels, just sort of rotated or different shots of the same image. So sort of episodes like this are kind of often reasonably scandalous. They call into question a lot. They raise a lot of issues. Everybody gets quite worked up about them. And so they're moments of kind of reflection. Now, what's interesting, I think, about why I kind of mentioned specifically this case is that it happened that at a moment when journals were doing more than just sort of trying to manage cases of outright fraudulent presentations of images. This was at a time when journals were really beginning to question more generally standard practices. So not cases of huge academic misconduct, but just the routine preparation of images for publication journals. And so if you look through sort of a number of the big journals, Science, Nature, the Journal of Cell Biology, some of the PLOS journals, between about 2002, 2006, you start to see a number of editorials that raise questions and concerns about sort of the trustworthiness of published images. So quotations like, in Nature's view, beautification is a form of misrepresentation. Slightly dirty images reflect the real world. So give us the raw images, prettify them for us. And then also sort of calls to say, well, data should be reported directly, not through a filter based on what you think they should illustrate to your audience. So these are sort of editors trying to take stands and talk with the scientific community about practices for image preparation. And a sense, too, that there's some action that needs to be taken, that perhaps we need to begin to find ways to regain trust in scientific images. So cases of fraud are one thing, but these are much more about kind of everyday routine scientific practice. And editors and journals at this time are starting to flag this up as potentially an issue for the wider scientific community. So editors are flagging it up, and it's also something that is becoming more of a growing concern in a formal way as well. So this is just a graph from the U.S. Office of Research Integrity, which is a sort of watchdog government body that is in charge of promoting research integrity and also investigating allegations of misconduct. And what's really interesting about this graph is that they're showing you kind of the number of cases that they open year on year where questionable images are part of the allegations that are being made. And you can see that around 1990, that very few, less than 10%, maybe 3% of the cases that they opened involved questioned images. By the year kind of, you know, 2003, 2004, you're looking at somewhere around, you know, 35%. 2007, 2008, they're saying almost 70% of the cases that they've opened to investigate are ones that involve suspected images in some way. I don't actually have, they haven't published since then a kind of tally of what the percentage is, so I don't know if it's going up or down. But it's a rather striking trend. So I think there's an interesting question, right? Why this crisis of trust now? So why at that particular moment, you know, in the kind of early to mid-2000s? And sort of one of the things that repeatedly gets raised by journal editors is a suggestion that this crisis is directly linked to the advent of digital image processing technologies. In particular, they tend to single out the increasingly routine use of Photoshop to prepare images for publication. And interestingly, if we go back to the previous slide, Photoshop came out in 1990, right? So this is, you know, there may be a correlation here, but it's hard to tell because one of the other factors that gets mentioned in this kind of may help to address the question of why right now, it was around the year 2000 that a lot of the bigger journals switched to electronic submission systems as well. So until that point in time, you would submit hard copies of your images to the journals. After that, you would submit JPEGs and TIFFs and so on, which by their very nature, the editors will say, are easier to scrutinize. So they would say it's not necessarily that scientists and authors were more angelic before. It's just that now it's easier to catch them. So you know, it's a particular moment in time brought together by potentially a number of factors, and that's just a few of them. And interestingly, journals are not the first, you know, to spot this. In fact, to some extent, scientific journals are a little late in some ways to be sort of questioning the use of digital imaging technologies. Back in 1982, there was a very famous sort of case of digital image manipulation on the front cover of National Geographic, where the pyramids of Giza were actually sort of brought closer together, partly because this was a constraint with the vertical format of the journal or of the magazine. They wanted to kind of bring them closer together so they could fit them both in the frame. But this actually caused a lot of debate at the time. So scientific journals, in some ways, they're not picking up on this on the early end. They're picking up on it sort of significantly later on, or 15 or more years later on. But I think one of the kind of interesting things here about journals is that they're particularly and kind of having worked there as well, I get some sense of this, particularly important sort of mediators in this regard. So scientific papers are probably the key vehicle for circulating knowledge claims among scientists. I mean, there are many other ways, you know, lab meetings, informal conversations, conferences, posters, and so on, but actually the published record really is a critical way of circulating knowledge claims within the scientific community, but also to the public more generally. So actually, most of the kind of science newspaper journalists and so on will look at the stories every week that are coming out in the big journals and use that as a for some of their stories, at least that week. And also, journals are in constant dialogue with the scientific community, right? Every week they're receiving submissions and papers. They have a very clear sense from month to month, from season to season, year to year, what the big questions are, you know, what the cutting-edge technologies are, what people are doing, and so on. And so they can be very sensitive to trends in scientific practice. And also, interestingly, particularly for some of the bigger, more influential journals, they can really help to steer and shape community practice by setting requirements in particular ways. So authors will do a surprising amount in order to get their publications in Nature or Science or Cell and so on, right? So if it's suddenly a requirement to make your data open access, to deposit it in GenBank, you will do it. If that means that you will get published in that journal. At the same time, though, I think it's worth saying that journals, at least in the case of image production and kind of this some of the difficulties around over-embellishing images, journals may be slightly complicit in furthering this as well, right? So, you know, in the drive to get yourself published, if you really want to make it in a big journal, you'd like your images to be as clean and beautiful and aesthetically pleasing as possible. In fact, you know, maybe the cleaner they are, the more chance you'll have of getting the cover page of the journal, right? I mean, that's a really, that's a big deal for, you know, to make the cover art, right? So to some extent, journals are sort of complicit in pushing aesthetically pleasing images. At the same time, they're in a position to be able to influence community norms in this way. So, Around the early 2000s, don't worry about the text on this slide. It's more just to say that around the early 2000s, a number of journals began to issue guidelines for digital image processing. The leading journal to do this, or the journal that really took the lead on it, was the Cell Biology. Nature quickly followed suit. Science quickly followed suit. The PLOS journals quickly followed suit, and so on. So what I'm going to sort of talk about for the rest of for the rest of this lecture is the guidelines that came out. So the guidelines that were published by journals around this time to do with digital image processing. And so I guess just to give you kind of an outline of what I'm going to do or how I framed it, what I did was sort of take a reasonably comprehensive survey of all of the commentaries and written reports and news articles about image processing guidelines that came out between 2002 and 2008, and specifically looking at the Journal of Cell Biology, at Science, at Family of Nature journals, and the PLOS journals, just to kind of get a sense not only of what the image processing guidelines were that they were coming out with, but how they were discussing them, how they were promoting them, why they were saying that these were important. And then, so looking at all of these and then trying to analyze them from the perspective of the social studies of science. As I said before, this was my first foray into the social studies of science. I had just started reading lots of literature. This is a field that is particularly concerned with the everyday practice of science. How does scientific knowledge get made? How do scientists work? What kind of practices do they follow? How do they communicate with each other? How do they build trust? How do they interact with others? And so I was reading all of these studies about how science is done and finding lots of really interesting work about images in those studies, you know, that had been done. And wondering, okay, so if we look at these journal guidelines, if we look at the commentaries associated with them, what is going on here? What are they saying about the role of images? Not just in publications, but in the scientific process writ large. So there kind of had a number of guiding questions that I was using to kind of analyze this from a sort of social studies of science perspective around, you know, well, how are the images actually being discussed and characterized in the journals? What aspects in particular of practice are the journals concerned with? Is it really the case that digital technologies do pose some kind of fundamental new type of threat to the credibility of images? Is there something particular to the digital here? To what extent will these guidelines assist with resolving this crisis? So this is sort of the kind of scope of the study that I did. So I'll just take you through quickly what the guidelines, you know, according to the ones that I looked at and how I analyzed them, a sort of perspective on what's going on here. So as I said, the Journal of Cell Biology was probably the journal that took the lead in trying to articulate and define guidelines for image production. And this is a long, you know, this is kind of a long paragraph. I'll run through it and then try and break it down in the next slide. But basically, the paragraph that gets copied and pasted regularly about image processing guidelines is this one. In many different forums, so Journal of Science Editors, or sorry, the Council for Science Editors, the Office of Research Integrity, and so on. So they say within this, no specific feature within an image enhanced, obscured, moved, removed, or introduced. The grouping of images from different parts of the same gel or from different gels, fields, or exposures must be made explicit in the way that you arrange the figure and must be described in the figure legend that you use. If you are going to do something like adjust the brightness or contrast or color balance, that's okay as long as you do it to the whole image and you don't do it selectively to parts of the image. And if you're going to make any nonlinear adjustments, then you must state this in the figure legend. So this is sort of, on the whole, the scope of the guidelines, or this is what the Journal of Cell Biology puts forward, and this is largely what gets adopted by a number of other journals. So just to kind of break that down and say kind of what, you know, into sort of the categories, I think, that are being emphasized here. One is very much about the scope of manipulation. So really suggesting that if you're going to make any alterations to an image, it really should be done across the whole image, that you shouldn't select parts of the image to adjust. The second is about sort of cutting and pasting and how if you are going to try and bring together results from a number of different experiments, that it should be very clear that they are a number of different experiments. You should kind of have panels that delineate them as such. The third, very much about transparency in process. So a lot of the journals are sort of requesting that authors are much more careful about noting the acquisition details, so what kind of make and model of equipment you use to capture the image, as well as detailing any of the alterations that you might have made. And fourth is the requirement to keep all the data. So if you look across kind of all the journals that have started to implement these guidelines, these are the sorts of points that come out. And just to give you a few examples, so just to kind of Again, these are examples that biology put forward to try and sort of make clear what they're talking about. So if we look at this first image here, they're saying this is the original one. This is the inappropriately manipulated image. Because in this particular blot, what's happened is the authors have selectively adjusted the contrast so as to make these bands disappear. So they've left these bands as is and selectively removed that. And they've also selectively removed this blot. Presumably, this is seen as an artifact, but and was removed for that reason, but this is deemed to be inappropriate according to journal guidelines, the removal of any artifacts. Another example with an electron microscopy image here that had been labeled with immunogold particles, where the authors selectively enhanced the contrast to show the labeling more effectively, and then also removed, again, removed a sort of spurious spot. Again, this is deemed to be inappropriate according to the guidelines. A third example to do with a fluorescence microscope image, where you can very clearly see, if you sort of analyze the image, that it looks like three cells here have been cut and pasted into this, into what the original image would have been, which is these cells right here, so that they've added a few. And I guess I should probably disclose that I split this panel up so that I could make the images bigger to, for you to see them. So I adjusted this image. I didn't change the content, but I did change the size and make it bigger. And finally, an example showing you the gradation of acceptable and unacceptable practices. So selective or increasingly severe contrast enhancements I think this is a Western blot. And so this is the original. This level of adjustment is deemed to be acceptable because they have adjusted the contrast, but they've done it to the entire image, and it hasn't resulted in the loss of any of the bands that you can see here. This one verges into the territory of unacceptability because you're starting to lose some of the detail. And this final one here is deemed completely inappropriate. This is actually just this band right here that has been adjusted to the extent where you can't see anything else on the blot. So these are the kinds of examples that they're putting forward. So just to summarize then, across, if we just want to take a step back and say, okay, what are the journals as a whole, not just the Journal of Cell Biology, but what is it that they're really getting these kind of with these images or with their guidelines? First, it's clear that they're mainly concerned with photographic images. They're not really providing guidance about how authors should prepare graphs or tables or diagrams or other types of images. They're concerned mostly with Western blots, images taken by a microscopy, and so on. In particular, they're concerned with cellular and molecular biology. But the guidelines that are presented, particularly in journals like Nature and Science, which are, as we know, very interdisciplinary journals, the guidelines are presented as being applicable to all images. So it's not selective to the cellular and molecular biology community. There's an explicit concern with Photoshop. And the concern is also about the stage of preparing images for publication, which arguably, from a pragmatic perspective, is the stage the journal has most control over, right? You know, they can request certain things when you're preparing an image for publication. As well as kind of proposing these guidelines or implementing these guidelines, journals are also supplementing these guidelines, which are designed for authors. They're supplementing them with their own in-house practices. So, for example, they're hiring forensic experts. A number of journals now have full-time forensics experts whose job is to scrutinize all images for signs of manipulation. They also, and then different journals have implemented kind of different ways of doing this. Them have protocols where they will spot check random sample of images that have been provisionally accepted for publication. Others, like the Journal of Cell Biology, will systematically scrutinize all images. And then upon discovering a potential case of manipulation that may have crossed the line, the journals then also have procedures in place for how they go about dealing with this. So, overall then, I mean, in some ways you say, okay, look, the guidelines seem fairly simple, right? Four main points, reasonably straightforward, we could just leave an analysis at that and say, this is what the journals are trying to do. These are the kinds of interventions they're trying to make. That's fine. One of the things that was really interesting to me is to kind of go a little bit deeper into this and say, okay, if we start then looking at these guidelines and what they're actually saying, what kinds of statements are they making about the role of images in science and in scientific publications? So let's try and analyze this a little deeper and say, you know, is this as simple, are these four steps as simple, as straightforward, as easy to manage as they sound or as they seem, and will they resolve this crisis? So what I'm going to do for the rest of the talk is really then kind of layer onto this the social studies of science analysis of what is going on here when we look at what seem like four reasonably simple steps for what is okay and not okay to do to an image. And the kind of key thing that I'm going to argue is that I think that what these guidelines do, you know, they come out at a particular moment in time, and I actually think exposing four reasonably fundamental tensions about the role of images in science writ large. So we're going to analyze them from the perspective of these particular guidelines, but that images have a very interesting place within the production of scientific knowledge, and that we can look at these guidelines and see the ways in which they're trying to kind of intervene and shape these four key long-standing tensions. So the first tension, and then I'll go through each of these in turn in kind of a bit more detail, but the first tension is really about how do you begin to go about separating out what counts as scientific and what counts as aesthetic practice? The second key tension is to do with distinguishing appropriate from inappropriate manipulation, and in this case, particularly when we're talking about digital technologies. But again, I'd suggest that's a fundamental tension. A third relating to the relationship between the author and reader in terms of presenting knowledge and evaluating knowledge when it comes to images. And finally, a tension between the objectivity of images and their persuasiveness. So I'm going to suggest that these are actually four tensions that are present across image production processes. And that what these, you know, and that these guidelines are intervening in these in very kind of interesting, slightly challenging and complicated ways. So we'll go through each of them in turn. But first, just kind of, again, from a social studies of science perspective, very quickly to say, there are a couple of core ideas that I'm going to have running through the whole thing that are worth flagging up front. So the first is that images, whether they're photographic images or not photographic images, are not a direct reflection of the natural world. Any image is simultaneously and unavoidably a product of the method that you use to create the image and the person who creates them. So even if you're just thinking about taking a photograph with your camera, right? The photograph is inevitably, you know, you have a particular, your camera has a particular resolution. It might be an SLR camera. It might be a film camera. And it might and you're always going to frame it. Right? So if you're on holiday and you just want that perfect shot and you take multiple images to try and get the frame right, the resulting picture, the one that you post on Facebook and you show to all your friends, is the one that you've selected because you framed it the right way. That photograph is not just a reflection of reality. It's a product of the camera that you used and of your selection of that site, right? And also the second part of this here is that really images are central to the everyday practice of science. They're not just about the communication of science with others. They're actually part of the process of knowledge creation within the lab as well. So images don't just come into being at the point where you want to share with others. Images are reasonably central to the practice of most academic science now. So let's go back to these kind of four central tensions that I said that I think the guidelines kind of bring to light and kind of help us to play around with. But these tensions have always been there, will always be there, and will never go away. It's just how we choose to manage them. So the first tension, as I said, relates to this kind of this interest or this desire or need to somehow try and separate scientific and aesthetic practices. And I think in the case of these particular journal guidelines, the journals are trying to say that scientific accuracy is more important than aesthetic quality. So they're saying things like, you know, slightly dirty images reflect the real world, right? That actually an accurate image is more important than an aesthetically pleasing image. Part of the difficulty or the challenge here, though, is that traditionally, I think these two features have been intertwined. So when you look at a beautiful, clean, compelling image, it tells you something about the effort or the skill or the expertise of the scientist who made it. So that, you know, that actually the kind of a scientist who's able to make beautiful pictures is seen as a skilled scientist. So the history of, and that leads you to trust in the work that they're doing. So while we may and assert that kind of accuracy is much more important than aesthetics, the history of seeing these two things as reasonably intertwined. The problem, I guess, that comes in with the advent of technologies like Photoshop is that Photoshop really threatens to kind of compromise this relationship, right? So actually, with Photoshop, the quality of your image is not necessarily linked to your skill as a scientist at the lab bench. It might just be linked to how skilled you are at manipulating an image on the desktop, right? So Photoshop kind of stands to threaten this relationship somewhat. And interestingly, I mean, Photoshop itself as a tool wasn't designed as a scientific tool, wasn't designed for the scientific community, right? And it's fascinating. I went and looked on the front page of, got this shot 2 days ago from the Adobe Photoshop website. And what was really interesting to me was the discussion, which I've put up here, but their text down here about the new release of Photoshop, talking about how it brings you unrivaled power and control to create images, designs, videos, and models that look exactly as you imagined. Right? I mean, that's almost antithetical to the practice of science, right? You're not supposed to just imagine what the world looks like. You're supposed to show what the world looks like, right? So, I mean, you know, the whole kind of the presentation, the ethos, the values that are built into Photoshop are not necessarily ones that sort of fit seamlessly with the scientific community. So it does threaten. It threatens that relationship between the scientific and the aesthetic that scientists have held dear, because you can imagine rather than show with Photoshop. So the way that the journals try to manage this, to me, is kind of interesting and curious. So what they do in practice is they say, well, we're going to draw a line, essentially, between adjusting an image before acquisition and after acquisition. So you have a lot more leeway and flexibility to kind of set things up. But once you've acquired the image, we'd like you to refrain from intervening as much as possible. So in a sense, what they're trying to do is they're sort of separating out the aesthetic and the scientific practice. So scientific practice is what you do at the benchtop, and the aesthetic practice is what you do at the desktop afterwards. And we're trying to limit or curb the kind of aesthetic component work through these guidelines. And things like, phrases like beautification as a form of misrepresentation sort of emphasizes that, right? Making your images more aesthetically beautiful is actually sort of compromising the scientific. I think the challenge here is that in practice, it's very difficult. When you start looking at scientific practice, it's very difficult to distinguish clearly between scientific and aesthetic practices. So, you know, aesthetic judgment is important and sometimes critical for the production of images that are meaningful or images that are persuasive. And this is where there are a number of studies from the social studies of science that really look in some depth at the image production processes and really show the extent to which the aesthetic and the scientific are intertwined in the production of a meaningful image. Not just an image, but an image that will tell a story and an image that will make an argument and an image that will be meaningful to the community that you're presenting it to. So this is just to kind of give you an example of one of these studies. This is a couple of science study scholars who sort of were acting as anthropologists and spending time in a lab where the scientists did an experiment, kind of an auto radiograph experiment, and really thought, okay, this is the publishable, you know, this is the data we're going to publish. The problem was their particular autoradiograph was not quite the right one to publish. So they were onto something, but they sort of, you know, this was an image that would get submitted. And so they followed and they looked at the conversations that the authors were having about how to make this a publishable image. The ways to make disappear the disturbing problem spots on the autoradiograph. So, you know, most of what they wanted was there, but there were some disturbing problem spots. And through analyzing the discussion, they kind of look at the number of different options that the scientists discuss as being possible to do in order to get the image ready for publication. So cutting the autoradiograph, just cutting off the bands that are problematic, taking less probe, labeling some bands as partial bands in combination with cutting others off, repeating the experiment, actually just exposing the X-ray film for a shorter period of time in the hopes that some of those bands wouldn't appear, repeating the experiment, but to eliminate one of the specimens that had created one of these troublesome bands and cutting off the other ones, or actually just letting the autoradiograph, like letting it run out longer so that some of the troublesome bands would run off the gel, right? Well, you laugh, right? But this is part of scientific practice. I'm not, you know, I mean, you know, this in a way is normal science. Is it, you know, these are the types of options that often get considered at the stage of you think you're onto something, and how do you go about actually producing that image that is acceptable? Now, I think that the interesting or the difficult thing when it comes to these image processing guidelines is essentially what the guidelines are saying is any of these is preferable to adjusting the image after you've acquired it. So, you know, I mean, because they've sort of drawn a line there between, you know, do what you like at the, not do what you like, but, you know, sort of, we're not really going to discuss what you do with an image before you acquire it, but we will discuss what you can do with an image after you acquire it. They're sort of ignoring the reasonably kind of comprehensive set of ways that you can begin that you can begin to kind of craft an image before you've taken a picture of it, right? And so I think this is a kind of case where by trying to draw this line between kind of benchtop and desktop, the journal editors find themselves advocating some slightly contradictory positions. So they explicitly say, for example, that they would rather that you perform multiple exposures to get the bands at the density you want. Interestingly, do it, you know, get what you want, without having to over-adjust digitally the brightness and the contrast of the scanned image, right? So this is, you know, sort of understanding to some extent normal scientific practice, but sort of drawing a line in a slightly problematic way. And I think it's because, you know, to some extent these guidelines really do focus on the process of preparing an image for publication. So they're not really digging deeply into the practices of image production that go kind of right back to the heart of science. They're taking the reasonably pragmatic step of saying we're concerned with the images you're submitting to us, and so this is where we're drawing the line. So that's just kind of one of the tensions, I think, that actually is fundamental to all image practices in science. You know, how do you get that image? What kinds of steps do you take? How do you set up your experiment? What controls do you run? How do you begin to construct what looks like a persuasive argument? That runs through all of science and has both scientific and aesthetic qualities about it. They're very difficult to tease out. So actually the guidelines that are being implemented really have to navigate this in a challenging way. So the second tension that I think then kind of runs through the guidelines, but also image practices more broadly, is then if you are going to adjust images after you've acquired them, what is acceptable and what is unacceptable? So defining what counts as acceptable practice at the desktop. And there's no suggestion. I mean, none of the journals are saying that it's unacceptable to do any image adjustment whatsoever. There's no, you know, there's, that seems possible, undesirable, that's not the issue here. The issue is, you know, where is that line between acceptability and unacceptability? And one of the things you could say is, well, maybe it's to do with the intent of the researcher. And that's a really difficult way to assess the acceptability of what's being done to an image. Because you can do things that might actually be reasonably misleading without the intent to deceive. So they can't go back and use researcher intent as a kind of clear way of deciding whether or not you've done something somewhat inappropriate to an image. So what the guidelines do is they distinguish between acceptable and unacceptable alterations to an image based on whether they affect data interpretation. So at the end of the day, whether or not your conclusions change based on the adjustments that have been done, is the kind of criteria that they apply. So what happens then is they sort of end up sort of with a tripartite structure of acceptable manipulations to an image are the ones that conform to the guidelines that have been set out. You know, so, you know, maybe overall adjustments, not selective adjustments, and so on. So if you comply with the guidelines and the interpretation of your data is not affected, it's an acceptable manipulation. It veers into unacceptable territory when you violate the guidelines, so you're maybe doing selective adjustments to an image, not holistic adjustments, for example. But at the end of the day, it's not affecting the overall conclusions. So this is actually the kind of stage that they're most concerned with, where it maybe doesn't have a bearing on the overall results, but some of the practices are inappropriate. And then kind of outrightly fraudulent manipulations that both violate the guidelines that have been set out as well as affecting the interpretation of the data. And that, as I said, this is really the stage that they're concerned with. I mean, this is the sort of normal practice of science where, you know, maybe the overall interpretation of the data isn't really affected, but you're sort of crossing lines of acceptability and what's okay in preparing an image. And one of the really interesting things here is that the Journal of Cell Biology, which, as I said, has kind of really been, I think, the most proactive journal in this regard, has been monitoring their papers since 2002. And actually, they sort of say that 25% of the papers that they receive contain one or more images that falls into this unacceptable manipulations category, and that this percentage didn't change over 6 years. So introducing the guidelines didn't have an immediate effect, at least, on this. I don't have the kind of latest statistics. It's 20? Okay, so it's dropped. It's dropped 5%. But thank you. That's really interesting. But this is the kind of stage that they're particularly concerned with. I think that the challenge then is, so reasonably straightforward, but actually making data interpretation the criteria is itself slightly tricky when you start looking at the practice of science. Because to some extent, the interpretation of an image is always context dependent, and it is always open to reevaluation by others. And the journal editors themselves are kind of very much aware of this too, that, for example, some observations that don't seem to make sense in the context of the original image may turn out later to be quite logical. So a really high background on your blot or something that might turn out to make sense later on, as you acquire more knowledge about the system. So the fact that there is never one single interpretation of an image makes the criteria of image interpretation or data interpretation somewhat tricky to absolutely kind of navigate. So what the journals do in practice is they say what we're looking at is not any possible interpretation of the data, but the interpretation that the authors put forward. So in a way, the authors have the control here to sort of say, you know, here's the argument we're putting forward, here's the images, here's how they support our conclusions. And it gets challenged if actually it's the author's conclusions or the author's interpretation that is really affected. So this is a way, these guidelines then are a way of sort of trying to make explicit to the authors their responsibility in making sure that the interpretation of their images fits and is appropriate to what they're publishing. So this takes me into kind of the third tension, which I said is a long-standing tension in science, again, which relates to the relationship between authors and readers of scientific papers. And I think it's in a way this kind of, we can go right back to the kind of history of science. Look at the way in which scientific practice emerged, right? Really to do with bringing together groups of individuals who would witness experiments. So a scientific fact was not thought to acquire the status of a scientific fact witnessed by others. So if you had done something, it actually wasn't sufficient to sanction it as a fact until others had seen it as well. And early on in the days of kind of natural sciences, this used to be done in situ, in a room, with people directly observing. And over time, since the 17th century onwards, when the first kind of publications really started to emerge, this kind of witnessing has increasingly happened through written form. So written papers increasingly become the way to advance knowledge claims to the scientific community. And once you advance your claim in the form of a publication, the scientific community then gets to evaluate. So they're reading, but in that sense, they are witnessing. They are looking for themselves. They are judging for themselves. They are seeing for themselves if the story you put forward is credible. But so I guess the challenge here is that today, with written papers, or, you know, I guess throughout the history of written papers, it's the authors then who begin to select which images and which data to present to readers. This is different from witnessing a live experiment where things might fail, some things might work, and you sort of seeing the whole spectrum of what's being done. Even that can often be somewhat staged, right? But when through the process of authors selecting what data images to present, this is necessarily limiting, at least to some extent, a reader's ability to witness. So you're sort of selectively presenting data. And in practice, we also know that, you know, in terms of publications, they're usually very constrained. You have a word count maximum. You have a number of figures maximum. You might be able to shove some stuff in the supplementary information, but actually you're really looking to present the best data you have. So you're going to select the best fluorescence images of your cells or the most representative Western blot, right? I mean, this is, it's about providing the most compelling persuasive argument that you can. And I think this raises a kind of interesting question as to, you know, the role of scientific papers these days. You know, to what extent are they really vehicles to allow a community to witness? Or to what extent are they kind of trying to play the more almost textbook function of, this is, you know, this is what this phenomenon looks like. I'm teaching you what it looks like. You're not so much evaluating, but I'm trying to teach you what it looks like. And the tricky issue around the kind of advent of Photoshop and some of the digital imaging technologies is that it grants authors even more control over presenting their images. So authors have always had this ability to select and present and choose the best data, but Photoshop kind of grants them even more power in that sense. So unbalances the author-reader relationship potentially even more. So by doing things like trying to limit the degree to which authors can intervene in the published image, requiring transparency, so detailing all the steps you took, you know, what, how you acquired the image, what transformations you made, and so on, you know, I think arguably what the guidelines are kind of doing is trying to assert, just trying to rebalance that relationship a little bit, give readers of papers a little bit more control in terms of being able to evaluate for themselves what you did. And there are some interesting developments, I think, in this regard that actually really take a step at trying to give readers of papers more control. So the Journal of Cell Biology, again, in 2004, launched what they call the Data Viewer, which is actually when an author publishes a paper, they are encouraged to make their original image files available on this online repository. And a reader then is encouraged to go and look and actually play with the raw images or play with the original images themselves. They can do image analysis on them and so on. So this is actually a way of almost a kind of a function enabled by digital technologies, interestingly, that allow you as a reader perhaps to have more witnessing power than you do on the kind of printed page when you're reading a paper. And so finally, the last tension that I think, again, is one that sort of runs rife through the practices of image production, is really this tension between objectivity and persuasion. So, you know, as a scientist, when you're writing a paper, you want to provide a persuasive argument. At the same time, you want this to be seen as an objective representation of the natural world. And there's a little, those two things are not necessarily at odds, but there's a sort of a relationship to manage there of how much of an objective kind of view of the world are you providing while also being utterly compelling to your reader. So I think, again, what the kind of guidelines are trying to do is really trying to sort of limit the exertion of sort of subjective interpretation and analysis of the author on the images. And what they're doing is they're trying to make appeals to the authors saying, actually, if you want to be objective, if you want to be presenting this objective view of the world, present the raw, gritty stuff to your readers. So actually, an authentic image is one that is a slightly dirty image. They say, we want to be presenting the gritty stuff. We don't necessarily want to be presenting the digitally beautified stuff. And in doing things like requiring annotation of all the steps that you've taken and so on, they're kind of implementing procedures. They're trying to kind of place image production in a kind of longer procedural context as a way of asserting objectivity as well. So these seven steps were taken. And actually, this has some very interesting parallels with discussions of objectivity. So there is a very weighty tome, about 700-page book written by these two historians of science that look at the history of objectivity over centuries and actually look at the ways in which objectivity has changed significantly over that period of time, because what it means to be objective has actually changed. What it means to be a good scientist has changed over several hundred years. And actually, In thinking about what it is that the guidelines are doing, I would say that they really are kind of reasonably strongly paralleling some of the a kind of appeal to mechanical objectivity, which is, as these historians talk about, a form of objectivity that was really concerned with kind of letting the camera do the talking, so trying to intervene as little as possible. Scientist was a scientist who refrained from intervening, who just pressed the button and then let the image speak for itself. And I think there's sort of a sense here of appealing to this more mechanical form of objectivity. And that's in the case of cell and molecular biology, right? So these guidelines have really been kind of brought about by a certain crisis in, or perceived crisis in, cellular and molecular biology. But interestingly, different disciplinary traditions actually have quite different conventions and norms for what it means to be a good scientist. So I think they're trying to advocate here that a good cellular and molecular biologist is one who really, tries to intervene as little as possible. But actually a good astronomer, and this is a kind of a social studies of science study that was done in the late 1980s of radio astronomers, and actually a sort of noisy image, as you see up here, would not be evaluated by the radio astronomy community as a trustworthy or good image. A good image and a skilled scientist would be one who could process the image, who could filter out all the noise, who was prepared to remove this artifact from the screen. So I think it's very interesting that we see different disciplinary traditions kind of understanding what it means to be a good scientist, understanding how you intervene in an image in different types of ways. And in a sense, this kind of appeal to mechanical objectivity is often a response that we see in situations of distrust. So it's sort of often a kind of reaction that happens when we're seeing these sorts of crises, when we're seeing expertise being challenged and so on. I think the difficulty of trying to assert a kind of mechanical activity ethos today is that we're dealing with much, much more complicated sets of equipment required to visualize molecular and cellular phenomena in the first place. So most of this we can't see with the naked eye. You can't validate that, the gene was present in your sample without actually putting it through a whole series of transformations to begin with that involve complex visualization technologies. So the question of what it really means to kind of be as removed from the production of an image as possible and just hitting the button becomes much more complicated, because from the outset, you're intervening much more in the preparation, in the actual generation of knowledge, not just in the kind of final publication. So I think this is an interesting question for kind of today's age of whether it's possible, whether it's desirable and feasible to kind of really advocate mechanical objectivity, or what it actually means to be a good scientist today. So what kind of objectivity are we striving for? So those are the four tensions, and I just a kind of two quick summary slides to try and just pull some of this together. So I think what I sort of started off by saying is that the journals, I think, are picking up in quite sensitive ways aspects of practice in cell and molecular biology that they feel need some attention, and are trying to come up with quite pragmatic, straightforward, simple solutions to really try and raise awareness of image production practices in science. But in doing this, I think this is an interesting moment then to stop and reflect. Why now? What's going on? What role do images have? And I think that the guidelines actually kind of bring to light or make visible a number of tensions that have always run through practices of image production and will always continue to run through practices of image production. So these are not new questions. They might be inflected in different ways with the advent of new technologies. And they're important questions to be continually being paying attention to. So it's not clear to me, for example, that simply saying that digital technologies pose a unique, fundamental threat to science in a way that didn't exist previously is quite the appropriate way of saying it. That actually it is kind of adjusting some of these relationships in new ways. It is opening new questions, but actually the fundamental questions are pretty similar. So to some extent, so I think the guidelines are very very welcome, very important contribution by the journals. But there is also, I think, precisely because images to the whole production of scientific knowledge, there's a limited amount that these guidelines can achieve by focusing right at the kind of endpoint of saying, you know, here's what you do when preparing an image for production. It's pragmatic on the part of journals. It's the part they can enforce. It is also a way of beginning to feed down into practice, because if you have to make transparent all your steps and you have to keep all your original data, it sort of means you should get into the habit of keeping all your original image data all the time anyway. So, I mean, it may feed into practice, but that's not what they're kind of asserting in this case. It's also clear that setting up very strict protocols is likely to be problematic. Because, not least because there's so much variation across techniques, tools, disciplines for visualizing, digitally processing, and so on, that you can't have very strict protocols, that these have to necessarily be quite general guidelines. And so, but in this sense, the guidelines could be very effective at raising awareness, beginning to nudge a community towards improving their practices, and certainly doing a lot to encourage traceability and documentation, which is something that in a number of studies, a significant proportion of scientists, so in this particular study, I think it was about a quarter of 3,000 biomedical scientists surveyed, were very open about saying that they didn't necessarily feel that they kept great records of their work. So, you know, the guidelines can encourage changes to practice in that way, even though they may not resolve the overall tensions. And I think they are starting, too, to restructure relationships of accountability. So in making clear what you can and can't do to an image, authors now have some responsibilities, journal editors now have some responsibilities, the role of the readers is potentially changing slightly, and so on. But what it does mean, perhaps unfortunately for the journals, depending on their resources, is that kind of a case-by-case evaluation will still be necessary. And in-house procedures for managing kind of scrutinizing images will still be necessary, because you can't make it a kind of infinitely detailed practice. So that's what I was going to say. I have published a couple of papers on this if you're interested, and I'd be very happy to kind of send them or share them with you. And just to say thank you very much, those are the other references that I cited if anybody is interested. So thank you.